Hi, everyone. Ooh, that's loud. So imagine that you're 10 years old. You're a little bit shorter than you are now. You're a little bit less stylish. But you're 10 years old and you're in Spanish class. So welcome to Spanish class. We are going to learn a word today. That word is run, which in Spanish is corre. Can you repeat after me? Corre. Excellent. Now we're going to do that 20,000 times. That's the average number of words that a person has in their speaking vocabulary. All right, so you're still 10. We're still in Spanish class. Let's try something a little bit different. Let's try playing a game that you might remember from your childhood called Simon Says. If you don't remember the rules, there's one basic rule. I'll say Simon Says and then an action, and you'll have to repeat after me, but only if I say Simon Says. So let's try it. Simon Says, stand up. Sit down. Simon didn't say. Get up. Simon says, nada. Simon says, anda en bicicleta. Simon says, corre. Simon says, you just won a triathlon. Oh my god. Congratulations, everyone. Simon says, you can take a seat. So as a 10-year-old, which learning experience did you enjoy more? the first one. We think language learning flashcards are a great way to learn, but we think we can improve them by actually mapping the words that are being described to the motions being performed, and that way, learn by doing. And for the first time in history, we have the actual technological capability to do this. Last year, Microsoft launched a brand new device called the Kinect. The Kinect contains a 3D infrared sensor that can map the entire room and the bodies within it. So when Judy first saw this device, she came up with this brilliant idea for a flashcard language learning game that would incorporate motion. She brought this idea to Startup Weekend a couple weeks ago, and Startup Weekend is exactly what it sounds like. It's one weekend in which you pitch an idea, develop the business plan, come up with a prototype, and demo it to a panel of judges and about 20 competing teams. So we spent the whole weekend developing out the basic unit, the basic flashcard that we would use to build this game. It's just like a game of Simon Says. You hear the word, the bear on screen performs the word, and then the player is supposed to repeat that action back to the bear. Let's watch a video of Judy performing this demo.
You guys need to.
Oh, sorry.
No. Yay!
As you can see, we were ecstatic that it actually worked. So our team is comprised of Judy, myself, and three team members who are here with us today, Lucas, Jen, and James. And we're a pretty diverse set of individuals, but what brings us together is this real passion for innovating at the intersection of education and technology. We think that there's incredible potential available with the virtual environments that you could create with a Kinect. And we are really enthusiastic about exploring all of those possibilities. But in order to do that, we also have to explore this belief that we share that children should not just be learning skills and knowledge. While those are important, we really want children and everyone to develop into lifelong learners. And here's why. We were amongst the first generation of kids to grow up with computers and the internet. We're what they call digital natives. While our parents might not be as comfortable with the idea of having computers and internet be just an extension of your mind, we're actually really comfortable with this thought. We're actually really comfortable with this idea that the internet is becoming this aggregation of all of human knowledge. So while knowledge and skills are still very important, there's a shift that we need to see happen towards creativity, critical thinking, and tenacity. That is, the creativity to come up with a project, the critical thinking to be able to figure out what we need to develop and how we need to build a team to get there, and the tenacity to Google the hell out of it and spend hours learning what we need to learn. So how do we make ourselves lifelong learners if this is the goal? We think that there's always been this dichotomy between learning that happens in the classroom, which is boring and serious, and you're sitting down and you're taking notes, and the playground, where you go and you play games and you have fun. But there are actually some really interesting similarities that we can draw out between learning and games. Let's take the game we played at the beginning, Simon Says. And compare that to something like math class. First of all, it's a social environment with a very clear set of rules. So in Simon Says, you should do what Simon says. And in a math class, you learn reading, you don't learn reading. You learn addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division. What's more, there are win states and there are lose states. So in Simon Says, if you do what Simon says, you win. And in math, if 1 + 1 = 2, not 4, you're doing good. However, there's one critical difference between games and the classroom, and that is, if you've ever played a game, you know that there's always an escape key. There's always a restart button. There's always a secret extra one-up life hidden somewhere. This just doesn't exist in the classroom. But humans need to be able to fail in order to learn. Think about it. We try something, we fall down, we get up, brush ourselves off, figure out exactly what went wrong, and try something new. We do this all the time as entrepreneurs. I've learned the value of failure firsthand from my dad, who I consider the epitome of a lifelong learner. As a middle-aged Korean man, he loved learning Italian, so he would bring his family, me, 10-year-old me, my sister, and my mother, to Italian restaurants and try to order in Italian. Buongiorno! Linguini con vongole! Yeah. The waiter would laugh at my dad, and my dad would laugh back, and then he'd keep on going. This was like the most mortifying thing that 10-year-old me could experience. But he kept on going, and what I've learned looking back on that is that the reason why he was such a great learner and ended up actually learning Italian is because he was not afraid to put himself out there, fall flat on his face, look kind of ridiculous, and try again. So most of us aren't as bold as my dad, and most of us don't find embarrassing ourselves in public as much fun as my dad does. So what can we do to make learning a language fun, engaging, and to make it an experience that kids and all of us will want to come back to? That's where Words with Bears comes in. Let's just walk through how this might happen in an example Words with Bears game. Turn on the Kinect. You see a virtual room. There's a hat, a piano, and a cat. Your bear, the friend, says, "Hi, let's go to the park. Would you like to put on your hat?" You don't really know English that well, so you check out the hat, and the piano, and the cat, and you go for the cat, and you put it on your head. Now, if this was real life, the worst thing that would happen is that you get a couple of cat scratches on your face and a really pissed off cat. But since this is a virtual environment, the worst that can happen is that the bear is a little bit upset at you, and you keep on trying, and eventually you learn the word. This is just one example of the ideas that we've come up with. With virtual environments, you can enable all kinds of learning experiences. You could teach the words for vegetables by creating a virtual soup. You could learn the names for animals by going to a virtual zoo. This is just a little bit of what we're coming up with, and we really think that the possibilities are wide open. So we want to invite you to come with us on our journey as we explore. We're Words with Bears. Thank you. Thank you.